As we roll down this unfamiliar road, and although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down.
I'm with Louisville Public Media, but I've been involved with Hand in Hand now for about 12 years. And just as a little background, I got involved at between jobs and did a trip to Belize and then to Nicaragua, and knew that I needed to be a little more involved with this organization. I know many of you have been on trips and you know what I'm talking about. When you see lives that are changed thanks to what Hand in Hand is doing, you want to be a part of that. So thank you all for being here this morning. We really appreciate that. We have a program that's going to run like clockwork. We'll have you out of here promptly at 8:30. Before we get the program underway, I do just want to thank our board of directors who are here. I won't make you all stand up, but thank all of our board of directors who are here. I had some past experience on the board as well, so thank you for being here. And their names are all up on the screens if you want to take a look there. Thank you. Also, thanks to our sponsors who make the breakfast possible. I will name them. You'll also see their names on there. Republic Bank, PNC Bank, Reliable Contracting, Video Kitchen, and thanks also to John Fitzgerald at Fitzio for the video today. To get underway, I'm going to bring up Deacon Greg Gitcher from St. Patrick's Catholic Church. Greg, his wife Tracy, and their three children all have been to Appalachia with Hand in Hand, and their daughter Madison also has been to Nicaragua. So coming up, Greg.
Good morning. Good morning. The Lord be with you. I invite you to bow your head for God's blessing. Good and gracious God, we thank you for this opportunity to come together for such a great cause. We ask you, Lord, to touch somebody in this room that's not only contributing their time and treasure and talents to come to one of these trips and experience the wonderful things that happens is we go down to help people, we come back realizing we're the ones that are helped. We ask blessings on everyone here today, on the wonderful organization, Hand to Hand Missions, for the food in front of us, the friends around us, and God's love between us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Good morning. Good morning. There's Steve Cute. I can hear him. There we are. Good morning. You know, there's such power behind a microphone. It's pretty cool when you can hush a whole crowd of 400 people. So thank you very much. Good morning. You know, when I look out at this crowd, I want to tell you all that I'm very, very thankful to each and every one of you who believe enough in our mission or trust your friends enough to come out on this cold morning at 7:30 to hear a story. So thank you. For those of you I've yet to meet, my name is Marla Cautilli, and I am honored to serve as the director of Hand in Hand Ministries. I'm blessed to work with a group of people who always, I mean always, go above and beyond. They handled every last detail of this event with incredible efficiency, giving me the freedom to spend a glorious week in California for my daughter's wedding just a few days ago. Actually, I was there about 30 hours ago. So thank you very much to my amazing staff. They even put together this nifty little video to help you understand a little bit more about our work. Little startup nonprofit with a handful of supporters and a budget of $26,000 grow to have donors from 46 states and an annual budget of over $1.5 million in just 19 years. Well, I'll tell you, the number one thing is it begins with a trust in God, followed by a mission that grips the soul, hands-on exposure to that mission, and the ripple effect. Let me give you an example. 7 years ago, Emma joined her parents on an immersion trip to Oxford, Kentucky. She enjoyed it so much, she invited a few friends to go with her the following summer. They loved it. She thought, hey, what if I talk to my principal at St. Patrick's and see if our eighth grade class can do this as a service project? He agreed to give it a try and headed to Appalachia with 23 eighth grade students and six chaperones. For most of these kids, it was their first exposure to poverty. It rocked their world. Everyone, including the principal, loved it. He told others. The idea caught on. Since that initial trip, 31 teams from 8 different middle schools have gone with us to Auxerre. That's 640 students and 256 adult chaperones who caught Emma's little ripple. But it doesn't end there. After middle school, Emma hosted an annual trip for her Sacred Heart friends, introducing another 119 people to our work. Now she's a freshman at Western Kentucky University, and you guessed it, she'll be leading 10 of her classmates to Nicaragua this time in March. It will be the first trip for Western, and I bet it won't be the last. Our motto at Hand in Hand is, lend a hand, change a life. I think we need to get Emma a t-shirt that says, lend a hand, change 1,000 lives. Emma, yeah, how about Emma? And she's such a good student, she's not here with us today. We'll get her here next time. Emma is just one example of how a single person's passion for our mission can ripple through a community. Let me share one more with you. Adam Koop is married and has 3 little girls. He volunteers as a mentor with Community Catholic Center in Portland. He recently returned from a trip to Auxerre with some of his students. And this is what he shared on Facebook. This weekend was more life-giving than I ever anticipated or prepared for. Myself and 3 other students went to a trailer of a single mom and a 7-year-old little girl that couldn't sleep in there because it was too cold in the night. We insulated underneath their house and installed underpinning to help make their home warmer. As we worked, this little girl played with a tin can and the scraps of wood from the lumber we were cutting. She built a pretend smoothie station with these items for her old stuffed animal that had seen plenty of love. It pulled at my heartstrings as I thought of my own girls back home, and I wondered what daily life was like for her. And while we didn't have a lot of money when I was little, I can't imagine life in her reality. Before I left, I decided to get this little girl a new stuffed animal and a warm blanket. I asked if she had been cold at night, and she said yes. When I handed her the blanket, she immediately gave me a hug that touched my heart more than I would have ever guessed. It was both the high and the low for the day. I could see the gratitude in her eyes, and I felt the outpouring of love in the heartfelt hug she gave. Yet my heart ached for so many other things that this family, along with many others, need. It's easy to go on a trip like this with a mindset that the goal is to get the physical work done. But it is so much more than that. It is just as important to make connections as human beings to people in need, people that deserve love and deserve a chance to have a better life. I received more than I gave in those 3 days in so many ways. You see, that's our magic. People love our mission and share it with others. People like Emma, people like Adam, and people like you. With God's guidance, a soul-gripping mission, hands-on exposure to that mission, and the ripple effect, we continue to grow. And we're not done yet. We have barely scratched the surface of our potential impact in West Louisville. We've already hosted 322 urban immersion participants. The 16 groups they represent are listed in the program. These groups turned a neglected park into a bright, colorful, welcoming space. They planted a tree. They turned abandoned spaces into bright, colorful murals. They made Cindy's house safer for her grandchildren. And they created an incredibly comfortable meeting space and retreat center for us in Portland. Yes, indeed. Thanks to all of you, Hand in Hand is firmly planted in West Louisville, and I'm excited. But please know this, our programs in Belize, Nicaragua, and Appalachia are thriving too. In September, the dream to put all of our Belize programs under one roof became a reality when we moved into the Fowler Community Center, a rock-solid building that will also serve as a hurricane shelter for the community. Steve Thornberry over there will tell you, it is rock-solid. There's a lot of steel in that building. It's not going anywhere. Here is a quick look at the evolution of the facility. Thanks to all of you who helped us fulfill the dream of our founder and those who followed in his footsteps, you made our dreams come true. Now, despite all this growth, please know that we are very much the same grassroots organization that began 19 years ago. We continue to commit 83% of all donations to programming. We still receive no government funding. We are not part of a larger parent organization. We are the international headquarters for Hand in Hand right here in Louisville, Kentucky. What makes Hand in Hand thrive is people like you. Whether you've been on a trip, or you write a check, or simply share our mission with a friend, your support propels our mission forward. Oh yes, we need ripples from Emma and Adam, and we need you too. Let's all start a ripple and see what we can do to change the world. One person, one family, one community at a time.
Everything that Hand in Hand does starts and finishes with the person in need, the person who's marginalized and impoverished or by whatever reason they have been unjustly treated by society. What I do here is to ensure that we are able to reach those people and give them as much help as we can.
When we first met her, she was so malnourished and she was so behind in her milestones that we realized it was a big challenge. Esther utilized our preschool or daycare. And we strongly encouraged it because we realized it would give us the opportunity to provide her with the nutrition also that she needed since she was so malnourished. In that process, we have helped her also to link with the medical care that she needed. When her mom passed away, you know, we were able to help her to get settled in her new environment, which was living with her aunt. And after years of being with her aunt, and her aunt passed away, we were still there. And we have watched Esther blossom. Without Hand in Hand, she wouldn't have made it this far. I have no doubt in my mind of that.
I think the good Lord sent me here to take care of Esther. I never knew Esther. And when I met Esther, you would not believe this. The first day I met Esther, you know what she says to me? Mom. Oh my God, my tears. And I just knew that Esther was gonna be mine. You know, like being my life, that was something like a calling. I don't know if you understand what I mean.
She has such a strong support. That is her grandfather. He brings her to school every day on a bike. And sometimes she doesn't get all the love that she needs from other people, but from him, she gets a lot.
Esther is a wonderful kid, you know what I mean? And you know, I'm just blessed, you know what I mean, for got Esther in a part of her life because even if Esther never disability, Esther will all the time show a joy for everybody because that's who she is.
Sometimes she comes to school, probably, maybe she didn't eat anything, but she still has a smile on her face and I wonder sometimes, how does she do it? So I say, if she's happy being who she is, how can I not be happy as well? And I have almost everything.
But sometimes she could tell. She'd be like, Mom. I'm like, what, baby? She said, "You worrying about me. Don't worry about me, I'll be fine, because you're here." I guess a little emotional sometimes. She's a good kid. I just want the best for her. My house is the 299 house. 300 house will be built next week in Dangriga for a really, really poor family. I wish I could go there and help them, but it's far away and I don't know nobody in Dangriga. I would like to if I could just nail some boards, you know, just do something for those children. You know, 299, that's gonna make 300 house that hands in hands built for people. Just imagine, 300 family. Come on, that's good.
And God knows why, you know what I mean? He have Esther here, and Esther here for a purpose. Esther is here for expire a lot more people, you know, to continue fighting, you know, because you got people, when you're down and your disability or you're sick and so you're easy to give up. Esther is not that kind of kid there. When you look at Esther, Esther is out and trying. Yeah, out and no care what you do and you tell Esther is out and happy.
Esther represents for me what Hand in Hand represents for the community. Because for me personally, when I see what Esther has to endure and she still has that radiant smile on her face, anyone that comes around Esther feels enlightened. They feel inspired. She's truly a beacon of light and hope for those around her. And that's what I want Hand in Hand to be for our community. That beacon of light and hope that people will always look to and come to when they need help.
From Esther was a baby, Esther was living in the hospital. Esther will come walk, Esther was disabled, Esther couldn't do nothing for her own self. Sometimes we think Esther will pass away in like a matter of a couple of months. But so far with the amount of help from Hands in Hands, she will live to get a happy life to the day.
I am doing it for Esther. Not for nothing, just for her. It's something that I have to do and that she's mine and I'm never giving up. I'm not giving up. I'm going to be with her till I close my eyes. I'm going to be with Esther. I could tell you that.
My name is Idalio. I am 13 years old and I live in Managua, Nicaragua. I am a grade 7 student at Loyola Institute. The final results aren't in yet, but I'm pretty sure I will be finishing the school year in first or second place in my class. I live in a neighborhood in Managua, which is very different from what I see here. My street is narrow and made of dirt. When it rains, it turns to mud, and because there are no drains, the water just runs by my front door. There are a lot of economic challenges in Nicaragua. Many people in my neighborhood live in houses that aren't well built. A lot of houses are made out of tin and the roof leaks when it rains. And we've had tons of rain this year. I live with my mom, Olga, and my dad, Idalio Sr., in a nice dry concrete house. My two sisters, who are 19 and 20, were living with us. But this year, thanks to Hand in Hand, they each got help to build their own small houses right next to ours. We all shared an outdoor toilet, shower, and a washstand to do our laundry by hand. We don't have internet in our house, so when I need to, I go to an internet cafe to do my homework. My father grew up on a farm and never had the opportunity to go to school. He cannot read or write. He came to Managua in 1980, right after the revolution, when he was 23 years old. He got work as a street cleaner in Managua, and eventually he got to work on a garbage truck. When he turned 60 this year, after 37 years of working for the city of Managua, he was forced to retire from his job because of his age. He gets a small pension. He helps my mom with her small business that she runs out of our house. My mother was born and raised in Managua. She went to school and finished grade 6. And at the same time, she worked alongside her own mother in the Managua city dump, collecting plastic, glass, and metal to sell. It was while working at the dump that she met my dad, who made lots of trips on his garbage truck. My mom runs a small business out of our house selling cooked beans. My sisters and I help out when we can. Before Hand in Hand started its program in Managua, both my sister went to public school and graduated from high school. Within a year of graduation, they both got pregnant, and now they each have a boyfriend and a baby. They stay home and look after their babies. To make money, one of my sisters makes and sells fruit drinks from her house, and my other sister buys and sells used cell phones. Most of the people in my neighborhood run some kind of small business. It could be selling cooked beans and fruit drinks like my family does, or selling tortillas, ice, or frozen drinks. Some people, like my uncle, catch fish in Lake Managua and sell them. Other people buy and sell used metals like copper, bronze, and aluminum, or plastic bottles. When it was my turn to start school, lucky for me, my mother heard about Hand in Hand scholarship program and applied. Because of Hand in Hand, I have been in a great private school since I was 6 years old. The program also helped with after school tutoring, English classes, art, and swimming classes. Through its program, Hand in Hand makes a great effort to remove all the obstacles that might prevent me from having success in school and university and beyond. When I'm not studying or attending classes, I love to play sports. Soccer, football is my favorite. Sports help a person grow and have fun at the same time. But also you can lose yourself and your problems and just express your joy through your play. I want to be an engineer when I grow up. I'm good at math, and I heard that that is important. I want to help poor people build safe homes for their family, just like the ones that Hand in Hand built with my sister this year. Thank you all for helping me and the other 89 students in the program.
And now it's my turn. I promise I will not be that interesting. Good morning, everyone. My name is Charisse Wright, and I am one of the newest members of the Board of Directors for Hand in Hand Ministries. So first, I would like to give honor to God and also thank Hand in Hand for this opportunity to share my journey and experience with this wonderful organization. Since high school, I have devoted time and energy to serving the community. It was a part of my DNA. I was blessed to have a village of family and friends, educators, and community servants around to nurture, to motivate, inspire, and encourage me to be the best I could be. So giving back was not only my attempt to pay it forward, it was also a promise that I made to my village and to God when accepting a scholarship at the UNCF Gala held at St. Stephen Church. I was blessed to attend a wonderful institution of higher learning in Atlanta, Georgia, Spelman College, where I continue to go on my journey in serving the community and others around me. Fast forward a little bit, post-undergrad, post-grad school, I found myself back in Louisville trying to find a purpose. I prayed and I eventually found a church home in St. Stephen. During one particular sermon, Reverend Cosby preached about the state of West Louisville. With all of the boom that was going around town, there was nothing west of 9th Street. Matter of fact, the conditions were worsening. I grew up in the east end of Louisville, and while my area high school would have been Seneca, I chose to attend Central High School right in West Louisville, and therefore I was educated in West Louisville. And although I don't live in West Louisville, I worship there, so I could not turn a blind eye to the conditions of a part of town that is nourishing me. I ask that you all take a second to close your eyes. Brief second. Picture all of the boom going around Louisville. The Omni, the Convention Center, Nulu, the expansion of Papa John's Cardinal Stadium, Whiskey Row. Now imagine just down the road, boarded up homes and businesses, vandalism, litter, unkept and vacant properties, streets with potholes so large you could do some serious damage to your vehicle. No growth, no opportunity, leading to violence. Now open your eyes. This is West Louisville. A true desert in the middle of an oasis. So what do I do? I knew that I wanted to serve the community, but how? I have no power, I have no major influence, no access to big dollars, but little did I know God was planting the seed for me to be an agent of change. In 2015, I was fortunate to participate and complete Ignite Louisville with Leadership Louisville. There, I met many young, inspiring people, including Ellen Haber. There you are. Sometime after Ignite, Ellen reached out to me. She was working for a small nonprofit organization called Hand in Hand Ministries, and they needed mentors for Seneca high school students, the very same high school I was supposed to attend, kind of making it come full circle. So I thought, why not? I can't turn Ellen down, and of course, that's right up my alley. I love working with kids. So while serving as a mentor, I met Allison Ridner, and she invited me to a free breakfast, the very same breakfast you're attending today. And you know, this was the breakfast that Hand in Hand Ministry was hosting, and she said that I could learn more about the organization that I'm working with and what they do outside of mentoring kids. While there, I was immediately drawn into the organization and how they serve others. So when the opportunity to chaperone the Seneca kids to Oxford, Kentucky to repair homes was present, I jumped on board.
In Eastern Kentucky on a service trip, I'm using real power tools, people.
I made a comment. I felt like Tim the Toolman Taylor. None of the other kids got that. No one got that except for me. So while there in Oxshire, I had the privilege to witness firsthand the goodness of this organization. As you can tell by the video, using power tools was definitely a highlight, but the best part was the bonding. I was able to bond with the people of Oxshire, the students of Seneca High School, and Marla, the director of Hand in Hand. Soon after the trip, Marla and I met for lunch, and we talked a little bit more. And that's when I shared what drives me to serve, along with the sermon that I heard from Reverend Cosby when he preached at St. Stephen Church, that had me really focused on doing my part to extend a hand to the communities of West Louisville. So our conversation went something like this. Marla, there are good people who would love to be homeowners in the West End, and there are good people who need work in the West End. If I can just find a way to work with the city to buy homes that are abandoned, seek out contractors and skilled labor from the community to rehab them, and then offer financing through a local bank to families who would take care of these homes, this could really be the change that would help jumpstart the growth that this community needs. I shared this little dream of mine with Marla, and she started talking about a little project called Urban Immersion. She also shared the idea of relocating the international headquarters of Hand in Hand to West Louisville. And it hit me. And for those who know me, the tears started to flow, because this entire time, I have been praying over the course of 2 years for a way to help, a way to carry out a mission that was in my heart, and asking God, how am I, just me, how am I gonna do this? The seed that was planted had been watered, had been fertilized, and Hand in Hand was going to help it grow into a full crop to be harvested. Soon after, I had the privilege of joining the board of directors, and I pledge to continue to carry out the mission of Hand in Hand and the mission that's in my heart, to pay it forward to those that cared about me in honor of my village here and in heaven. So I ask all of you today, how will you pay it forward? Thank you.
In a moment, the table captains will pass out pledge cards. This is your opportunity to join our family and help us make a difference. Before they do, I'm going to take a moment to walk through the giving options. I will start with the Legacy Society. Our first level of giving is Hands of Faith. This is a 5-year commitment of $1,000 per year, less than $84 per month, enough to build a wheelchair ramp each year in Eastern Kentucky. Next, we have Hands of Knowledge. This is your 5-year commitment of $2,000 per year, the cost of educating a child like Idalio in our Pathway to Change program in Nicaragua. Next is Hands of Hope. This is a commitment in the amount of $5,000 per year for 5 years, more than enough to build 5 houses in Belize. Finally, we have Hands of Love. This is a 5-year commitment of $10,000 per year. This is a gift that would have an immeasurable impact on many lives. We are hoping that right now, many of you will make the decision and commitment to join the Legacy Society, a decision which will result in changed lives for countless people like Esther and Idalio. We ask you to take a look at Section 1. This is where you decide your level of support. I truly hope you'll open the pledge card and be willing to join the people listed on your program and become a member of the Legacy Society by selecting one of the 4 levels of support. Our hope is to have at least 30 new Legacy Society members this morning. Don't pass up this opportunity to give less than $84 a month to change a life, even save one. For those of you who are already members of the Legacy Society, we ask that you consider increasing or extending your pledge. The last part of Section 1 is for those of you who would like to give a different gift, a one-time gift or a multi-year gift of a different amount, perhaps a gift of stock. Please know that every single gift, every gift, is very much appreciated, and it does help us to change the world, one person, one family, one community at a time. Section 2 lets you choose your payment schedule. We do encourage you to make a payment today. As you move to Section 3 on your card, we ask you to tell us how you'd like to pay. As always, we accept cash, checks, and credit cards. We are happy to set up automatic payments if you wish. As I mentioned a moment ago, we also accept stock transfers. It's easy to do and may have some tax benefits. We also encourage you to pursue matching gifts from your employer if that option is available. Anything you can do to help is much appreciated. When you are done with the pledge cards, please pass them back to the table captains. And while you're working on those cards, I want to take a moment to also invite you to join us on one of our trips. We want you to join our family, and we appreciate your financial support, but we want everyone to understand that we would love for you to come to Nicaragua with us, to go to Belize, to go to Eastern Kentucky. You can always just call the Hand in Hand office, and they'll give you all the information you need. Thank you again for your commitment. Your gift strengthens our effort and provides immeasurable results around the world. Now I'll turn the program back to Susan to wrap up. Thank you.
Nothing official to wrap up. I do want to thank you all for coming this morning, Idalio and Charisse, and loved hearing Esther's story as well. Thank you all for coming and speaking to us, and Scott for leading us on the board as well. And of course, Marla is amazing. So thank you all for being here this morning, for getting up early and joining us, and we look forward to seeing you at another breakfast, and have a great day today.